Thank you. That's not that. That was six knocks of the glass, which means it's a high quality conversation. The more times I hit the glass, the better the conversation. What are the challenges we're facing? Now, we know this side of the room from yesterday is the creative, pulsating side. What are your challenges? No, they're not. Okay. What are the challenges we're facing? Anybody? That is always a challenge, migrating to a new learning management system. What's your biggest challenge as a part of that? Yes. Oh Lord! Right, transforming you're transporting your historic data, user data, and course data.
Yes.
Right. Okay. You can hear that. It's a bit like when you take your car to be fixed. There was a sort of. No. What they are with you? They're supporting you. What's your name?
Christine.
All right. Okay. Are we all supporting Christine?
Yes.
Right. There you are. We're all supporting you. And. We're going to, if anybody's got any help for Christine, then please supply it, because we know that going from one LMS to another one is a challenge, and you've got a body of people here to help you. And in fact, of course, we've all got that on the Learning and Skills Group, our community website, so please feel free to go to that website and post questions and garner the support from this group, not just over these 2 days. Learningandskillsgroup.com is a free community for us all to use. Incidentally, that's also where the videos are from these sessions and also the PowerPoints from these sessions. So that's a quick plug for the site. Anything else? Challenges people have got? No. Yeah, it's great. Day one, we've solved all the challenges. Any other challenges?
Measurement.
Of?
Learning. Showing our worth.
Showing our value. Right. Does that mean, or what does it mean for you?
We have proof of business, so we actually make a difference.
Yeah. Anybody got any top tips for, sorry, what's your name?
Ricky.
Ricky, okay. Okay, if there are any top tips for Ricky, then please seek her out and give top. There are, of course. It's a personal passion of mine. We can have a long conversation about that over coffee. We can do it. You can do it. But it's all a matter of talking to people, isn't it? Find out what really matters to the business. Those are two actual real challenges that we've got in learning and development, and I'm delighted that they're being brought up. I think they are perennial. They keep coming back to us, and of course, we'll keep trying to fix them. But please, let's remember that this thing doesn't... Well, this event closes this afternoon at 4:30 over drinks, but we don't stop then. We do keep going throughout the year. So come back to the Learning and Skills Group, post the questions, how can I do this, and people will support you. We've got 10,000 people there, and they are there to listen to these issues and to pitch in with their support. So let's make this not just a two-minute conversation here, but a prolonged debate between ourselves. That's enough from Don Taylor. Time to hand over to our keynote speaker this morning. Now, yesterday we had a real focus on technology. This morning we've got a real focus on learning, thinking about storytelling and learning and how learning and storytelling are intertwined. To do that, we've got Deborah Frances-White, who's a great conference favorite, a stand-up comedian, and the creator of The Guilty Feminist, a very popular podcast on Radio 4. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Deborah Frances-White.
Hello. Thank you, John. Thank you very much. Morning.
Morning.
Mwah. So, hello. I'm going to talk about story for learning. I'm going to tell you three things about myself at the top. One, my primary school was called Palm Beach because I was raised in Australia. I had a wired head terrier when I was a little girl called Lexi, and I was left-handed and still am. Have carried that through, like the professional I am. And I'm now going to tell you a story about when I was a child. So when I was 7, I went to a new school. I didn't sort of have that many friends yet. You know when you're trying to sort of get in at school to a sort of group? I wasn't bullied or ostracized. Don't feel sorry for me. I just hadn't found my clique. You know, I hadn't found my gang yet. And the teacher... stood up one day and announced something that I thought, this is it. This is how I'm going to get friends. She stood up. She was the aptly named Miss Power. You know her. You had her. But she actually had that true Dickensian name, Miss Power, and she stood up and she said, "Right, there's going to be an inter-school dancing competition." Again, we're in Australia. There's going to be an inter-school dancing competition. And that means we're going to be choosing 4 lucky girls to learn a dance routine, and then we're going to take that dance routine and we're going to take it to the national competitions where all of the other schools will be dancing, and we're going to see if we can win a trophy for the school. And all the girls in the break were like, "Oh, do you think we're going to be able to audition?" And we're 7 years old. And let us be incredibly clear, what we were being given an opportunity to do was to dress up in a fairly inappropriate sparkly leotard and writhe in an incredibly inappropriate way to pop music. And I'll never forget the song that we were dancing to, that we were auditioning for. It was Kung Fu Fighting. "Everybody go Kung Fu Fighting. Ha, ha." Remember that song? Yeah, I do. So that was the song that was propositioned. We were told that quite soon this opportunity would come up. So I went to dance class after school, like lots of little girls did, virtually everyone in our class. I went and I was kind of practicing and sort of trying to get good, because I was thinking there'll be an audition coming up. And then about a week later, Miss Power stood up and said, "Right, today we're going to choose the girls for the inner school dancing competition. All the blonde girls stand up." And all of the blonde girls stood up, and all of the brunettes, we were just sort of sitting there going, And then she walked around the room, pointed at the blonde girls she thought were the prettiest. She made them line up against a wall. She said, "Right, go on, stand up against a wall." And then she went down the line, pointing out the blonde girls she thought were the prettiest. And she said, "Right, you. And then she turned back to us and went, "And Janine Henney." Now, Janine Henney had brown hair, but she was an awesome dancer, and she had the trophies and the pennants to prove it. And she got moved in with the 3 lucky blondes because she was a good dancer. And it was at that day that I realized that if you were blonde, if you were brunette, you needed a talent. This wasn't going to carry you through. You needed more, you needed extra, and you needed to have previously demonstrated your skill. And I remember thinking, how old do you have to be before you can dye your hair blonde? Like sort of trying to research it. I mean, it was well before Google, obviously, Kung Fu Fighting. I was sitting there going, like, how do I become blonde? And I look back on that now, and I see that story very differently through the lens of a grown-up. Now, I'm going to ask you, who thinks with sort of some reasonable amount of certainty, don't shout out, but put your hand up if you think you know the name of my school. I told you at the top. Great. Who doesn't know? So that's the opposite of not shouting it out, that's shouting it out. Put your hand up if you can't really remember the name of the school. Great. Okay, so about half and half. Put your hand up if you think you know the name and the breed of my dog. Great. Name and breed of dog. Put your hand up if you don't know. Great. Okay. Put your hand up if you remember the final fact I gave you about myself before I told the story. But, no, signal it to me. Signal you know. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that's cleverly done. Cleverly done. Put your hand up if you have no idea what the third fact was. Great, interesting, and there was a multiplicity there. So, okay, what was the name of my teacher? Just put your hand up if you know that. Put your hand up if you don't know the name of my teacher. Great, okay, super. Only really single digits. Don't remember that part of the story. If you know the name of the song I dance to, can you just sing it? 2, 3, 4. Very good. Was anybody not sure before we started singing? Everybody not sure? Great, okay. Here's the thing. There's a reason why about half of the audience can remember the first lot of facts, and nearly everybody in the audience can remember the second lot of facts. And it's because the second lot of facts were told within a story. They were kind of smuggled into a story. And here's the thing, though. That's not what we learnt from the story. Stories make facts sticky, but that's not the reason to tell stories. What can you deduce from the fact that I had a dog? Just shout it out if you know what my dog was. What kind of breed? Whitehead Terrier. Very good. There's some very. That's. It's very important. She was social. She was social. Are you a dog person?
No.
No. You're just sharp as a tack. Shout out if you know her name.
Lexi.
Yes. Very good. What can you deduce from that? Any deductions you can make at all? Not a cat person, and that actually, that deduction so would be incorrect, because after that, I always had cats, and now I have cats, so I would say I'm more of a cat person. So from that piece of information, you can actually deduct something that is wrong. It is true that I had a dog called Lexi. It is also true that I'm a cat person. Anything else you can deduce from that? You can just, there's a couple of things you can deduce. I like dogs. Yeah, I do. I like cats more. There are white-haired terriers in Australia, you could deduce. Lexi's a girl's name. I actually gave that away by saying she at one point, but you could probably work that out. There's a few like tiny vague things that you could deduce from that. What you don't really learn anything from the fact that I'm left-handed. You already knew some people that were left-handed. You don't really learn anything. If I hadn't told you Australia, but I said my school was called Palm Beach, what could you deduce from that? Yeah, by the sea, that maybe I would have gone to school somewhere by the sea. So we're always gleaning little things, right, from facts. We do glean little things. What did you take away from the story about Miss Power and the dance competition? Unfair, yeah. The thing that life is unfair, great. What else? What do you take away from that? If you tell someone else that story, why do you tell them that story? What are you learning? There's all sorts of things you can learn from that. What's the beauty standard in Australia, or certainly was then? Blonde hair. That blonde hair in some places is considered to be superior to brunette hair. That there is a beauty, there's an added value beauty in blonde hair. Miss Power's quite racist when you look at it. What might you take from that? So there'll be some people in the audience who'll go, huh. If you've got kids, what might somebody in the audience with a specific situation with their child deduce or do differently because they heard that story? Like maybe this week. What was that? Dye their hair earlier. Sometimes people misunderstand the point of stories. Get in really, before they even need to know they're brunette, just get into, there's no need, they should be raised with that disadvantage. They never need to know. There might be someone in the audience who might go, do you know what? I've had this weird suspicion that my child is being a bit bullied by their teacher. Do you know, and it might just sort of just hover with them, and next time they see that teacher pick up at the school gate, might just say something to them, or how are they getting along, or their child might have been for ages coming home crying about the teacher. Like, right, that's it, I'm going to go in, because these things can stay with you, right? Some people, what if someone in the audience was thinking of dyeing their hair or changing their appearance in some way? What might they take from that? Dye it blonde again, sir. I don't know if that's the same person. Yeah, that as a woman, a talent is worthwhile. That we might get a bit annoyed at Miss Power and go, that's so superficial. Appearance isn't important. How many people here, just, we won't put your hands up, but just close your eyes and just go, if you are ever dissatisfied with your appearance. If you close your eyes and everyone goes, then no one will know who's mm. So everyone close their eyes? Okay, if you're ever dissatisfied with your appearance, go, If you wish it were different sometimes, go, If you hear that story and you think my appearance should be different, go, Interesting, right? Okay, so So that story makes you think, hold on, why are we judging women by their appearance? Why are we not, why were we not auditioned to see who the best dancers were? That's what it makes us feel. Why is life not more fair? And why are we so interested in the superficial? And that story can change how we feel about superficial things. So somebody who's going, I've got to be thinner, or I've got to be blonde, or I've got to be this or that, might think, no, do you know what? I'm awesome the way I am, and I'm incredibly talented and brilliant at my job, and I'm not gonna feel like that. Here's the thing about stories. Stories are events that we can learn from. That's what they are. The reason we tell each other stories, the reason stories exist, is so that the listener can draw a conclusion which they can use in their life. That is what stories are. Sometimes people go, oh, it'd be nice if we had a story here because it would make this learning more interesting. Or let's not have a story, people will feel patronized. That's the two things I think people feel about story and learning. But stories are the way human brains have developed learning. That's what they are. That's the very reason we told stories in the first place. Every story has a moral. Every story has a conclusion that you wish your audience would get, would take away. You tell a story in a way because you want your audience to feel differently or to change their behavior or both. So here's an example. This is a story. My friend Margaret, she was in Paris on a just sort of, you know, mini break thing. She went up the Eiffel Tower, she was on her own, and she met this guy at the top of the Eiffel Tower, and they were just kind of, he was there on his own as well, they were just having a sort of chat and started to be a bit flirty, and they had a joke, and then they went their separate ways, and she didn't, you know, want to say anything, and she got back down, and then she went to a cafe, and she went to the Louvre, and she just couldn't stop thinking about him. And she thought, oh my God, he's the one, and I've let him get away. Hold on. It's just a photo opportunity. Otherwise, you just get all these photos on Twitter of you going, I'll do a natural one for you if you like. You've missed your opportunity there. Happy? Good. She just couldn't stop thinking about him, and she thought, my God, maybe he's the one. And I'm such an idiot. Why didn't I just say, can I have your number? And she remembered, she'd asked him why he was there, and he said he was at a conference, and she didn't know the name of the conference, but she knew the industry he was in, so she started Googling. She found the conference that he was going to, and she went to the conference, and she snuck in and sort of hung around in all the right places until she bumped into him and pretended to also be at the conference. And then they obviously went and had lunch together and wine and stuff. And then she eventually just said, look, I'm really sorry. I'm not at this conference. I can't pretend I'm at this conference for the rest of my life. So I'm going to tell you now. I found it because I just liked you so much. And he was like, oh my God, thank you so much for doing that, because all I've been able to think about is you. I've been so distracted. I can't believe you've done this. And they are now married and have been married for 15 years. What does that tell you? What can you learn about love from that story? Stalking is good, yes. Or, let's put that in a more positive way. Taking a risk, yes. Sometimes you've got to take a risk for love. Now I'm going to tell you another story. Okay, so my friend Margaret, she went to Paris on a mini break. She just thought, screw this, I'm going on my own and just, you know, feeling a bit lonely. And she goes up the Eiffel Tower like you do, and she's at the top, she meets this great guy called John, they have a flirt, they have a laugh, walk off, she can't stop thinking about him. She's just shopping in Paris thinking, oh my God, he's the one. She Googles the conference he's at, she goes to the conference, she bumps into him, they go for lunch, they have a few glasses of wine, and she says, this is going to be up front, obviously I'm not meant to be at this conference, or I would have said at the top of the Eiffel Tower. It's embarrassing, but I just really like you, and I just thought, I can't leave Paris without seeing you. And he was like, okay. And he just went, sorry, could we get the bill? What's the French word for bill? And he went pale and he left. And she was just so embarrassed. She was just like, so devastated. And she has never done anything like that. In fact, she was on Match.com and she came off after that. Honestly, that episode for her was the thing that made her just go, I've withdrawn from dating. And she actually hasn't dated for 10 years, to the extent where I set her up at a dinner party with someone who asked her out and she wouldn't go. What did you learn from that story? Thank you, yes. Stalking doesn't pay. And here's the thing, when you're sitting around at dinner, you know, if you go out with your best mates and someone's telling a story like, I met this guy and I don't know, and I've looked him up on Facebook, but is it weird? Is it weird to just contact him out of the blue like that? A romantic will tell the first story. But oh no, I had a friend. And a pessimist, who's perhaps been burnt in love, will tell the second story. Don't do it, he'll think you're a stalker because my friend dot, 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 or I did dot, dot, dot. What we do is we take the feeling we've got and what we want our friend to take away from it, we tell an appropriate story. And both those stories could be true, yeah, for different people. Both of those things will have happened. Someone's taken the risk and they've ended up in love. Someone's taken the risk and they've ended up embarrassed. Both of those things must be true. But what we do is we tell the story that we wish our friend to learn from. And they go, oh, you're totally right. Of course I should go after him. I want to be as happy as John and Margaret. I will do it, I'm doing it now. Because they're emboldened by your story. That's what happens. Or they'll go, no, you're absolutely right. Of course, he'll think I'm a stalker. I absolutely mustn't do that because I don't want to be sad Margaret who cannot look a date in a face. Absolutely can't do that. That's what we're doing all the time. Now, here's the thing about my story. Different people will have taken different things from the story. Different people could remember the name of my dog, about half the audience. Nearly everyone in the audience could remember the name of Miss Power. Why? Why could you remember the name of Miss Power? Yeah, because she was on the spine of the story, right? Because her name was relevant. She had all the power over me. If her name was Miss Anderson, about 50% of this audience would have remembered it. Miss Power is only important because it screws into your story. If her name had been Miss Anderson, I probably wouldn't have mentioned it. I mentioned it because it evokes a feeling. But here's the thing. So stories are better for learning because most people couldn't remember the first and they could remember the second. But here's the thing. In 5 years' time, nobody in this audience will be able to remember that my school was Palm Beach, that my dog was called Lexi, or that I'm left-handed. Furthermore, no one will remember that they have forgotten it. It will never come up again. It's never going to come into your head. I mean, it might now because I'm going on about it, but... Do you see what I mean? But some people will tell the story out of this room of a girl who was brought up in Australia and there was a teacher who chose only blondes to do a dancing competition, wouldn't audition the brunettes because they were obviously not attractive enough to dance. People will tell that story. Now, most people will forget the facts. They'll forget odd facts. Most people won't know that the teacher was called Miss Power in a year's time. Someone will tell that story in a year's time because someone will say, someone here in this room, someone's friend will go, my daughter's only 12 and she wants to dye her hair blonde. Do you think I should let her? Oh, well, I heard a story, blah, blah, blah. Someone else in this room, their friend will go, I'm sure that my child's teacher is a fascist. they're coming home with all this stuff. Well, I heard a story. Blank, 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 right? But most people will forget that my teacher's name was Miss Power. Most people won't bother mentioning that the story was Kung Fu Fighting. It's more likely that you'll remember the story, the song was Kung Fu Fighting because you sang it. Because I sang it, then you sang it, right? So that'll probably be a little bit embedded in you. But many people, if in 5 years' time, will still remember that story, but the story will have totally changed. Some people will tell a story in 5 years' time that they saw a speaker who went to school in Australia and the teacher dyed all of the children's hair blonde because everyone in her class had to have blonde hair. She didn't want to teach brunettes. That's how far the story will go. right? Someone else will tell a story about, there was somebody and it was like a school play and she only wanted blondes, but it wasn't the sound of music or anything, right? The details will change. Have you ever told a story, tried to tell a story with your partner at a dinner party? No, it was definitely December because we hadn't had the kitchen done yet. And how is that relevant? How do these people care? You've just interrupted the flow of a perfectly good story to explain that it couldn't have been Marjorie because Marjorie was dead by the winter. So what? Okay, it wasn't Marjorie, it was Peg. It doesn't matter. Somebody went in and checked and there was nothing there. That's the point. Does anyone else have this problem? I don't feel like enough people. Yes, just put up your hand if you have this problem of a partner or similar who keeps interrupting your stories. Yeah, nearly everyone in this audience has had an experience with a partner who goes, my husband now goes, can I tell it? Can I tell it? And I go, yeah, of course you can tell it. And he starts at the wrong place. And then I have to be the bad guy and completely correct his story, which is wrong. He's not telling it right. But here's the thing. Nobody in 5 years' time who leaves here, even though all the details will go wrong, the way that I hear my mother telling stories that I've told her and I think I said nothing like that. But what you won't forget is the point. So the story you tell in 5 years' time about the school teacher who died in Australia, who dyed her, the pop group's hair blonde, the point of the story will still be the same, which is when people have too much power, sometimes they make life unfair for people who don't have power, and sometimes that life is made unfair because of superficial reasons or reasons that we just kind of go, do you know what? You're really teaching those children the wrong thing about what is valued. Nobody in 5 years' time is going to think that I wished I'd had brunette hair and been cleverer. No one's going to think that. That's not the detail you'll forget, because spine of the story, what's important to the story is that message. So anybody who tells a slightly different story will always tell the same moral, right? So when you hear your mum tell the story about the story and it's totally wrong, the moral is always the same. And when you are bored by somebody's story, it is because you can learn nothing from it. So do you know when you ever visit a relative or someone and they go, oh, Harold went down the bowls club this morning. You go, yeah, did he? Yeah. Was wet down there. They had a bit of problems playing bowls this morning. He still played bowls, but it was a bit wet for him. And on the way back, he stopped for a pint with Roger, and he hasn't seen Roger in a long time. And I say to him, you should see more of Roger, and he doesn't see more of Roger, so I'm glad he's seeing something of Roger this morning. I can take nothing from that. That's just events. And it's being presented like a story, so you're meant to go, oh, but we've learned nothing from it. So if a story is dull, what you're presenting is just one thing after another. That's why most presentations in the corporate world suck. Because they're just a series of slides. So in this first slide, we're gonna have Harold down the bowls club. And on the second slide, we're gonna have sometimes bowls clubs are wet. And on the third slide, we're going to have Roger and Harold having a pint. And in the fourth slide, we're going to have, they talked about Spurs. That's what most presentations are. Most presentations, you could take the slides and you can shuffle them up in any order. And you can go back and go, Roger and Harold talked about Spurs. Harold played bowls. Roger and Harold had a pint. Bowls clubs are wet sometimes. It doesn't make much difference. Got the idea. Those things happened. It doesn't really matter what order they happened in. And that's because they lack the very crucial thing that make all stories work. And that is because of that, cause and effect. And that's why you argue with your partner about how best to tell a story, because sometimes you go, no, but you've missed out the crucial bit. You've missed out this, because of that, this happened, right? So you're intuitively brilliant storytellers, all of you. When you watch a movie, you are always guessing what will happen next? If the first scene is a boy from uptown and the second scene is a girl from downtown, what's the third scene? They meet, yeah, sure. And if it's not, you want to know why. Ah, what else? What's being put, because they definitely are going to meet. And if they never meet, you'll be disappointed, because that's what you've been promised. That because of seeing this, we're going to see that, right? And if they never meet, well, it's probably a French film. And there's, let's be clear, nothing wrong with French films, except there's a much smaller audience for them, because there's not as clear cause and effect, yeah? People just sit and chat for a while and then this happens, but this doesn't happen because of that, right? So you're meant to take more sophisticated things from a French film. If you want a broad audience of people who are learning from you to be able to learn from you, cause and effect, because of that, this. So when you're watching a movie, you are an absolute expert storyteller, always. You sit there going, oh, okay, I know what's gonna happen. They're gonna rob the bank. Or she's going to rob the bank and blame it on him. Oh, they've robbed the bank. Okay. So now they've robbed the bank. You now have another guess. Either they're going to lose the money or he's going to steal the money and leave her with that. Okay. Okay, he's stolen the money, but he's told. Okay, all right, I see. Okay, now I'm going to make another guess. And you've always got two or three guesses. Anytime I paused a movie, if I said, guess what's going to happen next, none of you would go, I've got nothing. Nothing could happen next. Because that's how human beings' brains work. We justify, we rationalize, we guess. If you went home back to your hotel room or flat or house or whatever tonight, and all of the drawers were turned upside down, and everything was everywhere, and your jewelry and various things were gone, what would you guess has happened? Very few of you would go, it's no explanations at all. It's not how I left it. It's changed. I got no theories. We all, this is what we do all the time, yeah? If you come home and your fish tank's upside down or you're, you know, you start going, was the window open? Did the cat knock it over? Did someone break it? Did someone come home? Who could have come in? Did the cleaner come in today? Was Mike home for the weekend? You start going through all of the possibilities. You don't go, that's happened, I've got nothing. This is what we do as human beings. So as soon as you have an A and a B, the audience are hoping they meet. As soon as you have an event, what the audience are hoping is not that there is another slide. Very few audiences are hoping for another slide. So few. What they're hoping is for a because of that. Now, in the corporate world, they're often not waiting for that because they don't expect it. They expect another random piece of information. But there's a reason why it's easier to watch Die Hard than it is to watch a documentary about crime in your area. So if you're watching something like Die Hard and the phone rings, you might just let it ring, right? You might go, I'll call that person back because I don't want to miss this. Or you'd pause it, right? You wouldn't, or if you're, you know, if you're in a cinema or went before we had pause buttons, if anyone, I'm just looking at you, you probably can't remember that, but there was a time when you had to be in for a show, sir. And then if someone knocked on the door, you'd miss a crucial bit of the show and it was very annoying. He's 12, he doesn't know. But you might ignore the phone because you're so into Breaking Bad, for example, right? If you're watching a Netflix, that's what Netflix is doing, it's brilliant. That sort of binge watching. Binge watching relies on because of that. So where do they leave the episode of Breaking Bad? Do they leave it on a resolution where, okay, well, so this week, we've seen Walter White, he's gone to a bit of trouble with some drug dealers, but that seems to be resolved now. So next week he might meet another really scary, terrifying drug person, but still it seems all right now. He's gone home to his wife and everything seems calm and all right. Because there's no because of that there. So you're not gonna watch another one. So you're gonna go, I can go to bed now. I can get a full 8 hours sleep. What Netflix is doing is eroding your sleep by making you guess what comes next. Because of that, what can possibly happen now? How can Walter White possibly get out of this? The guy's got the gun to his head. There's no reason for him not to shoot him, but I'm guessing he doesn't because there's no more show if Walter White's dead. Sorry, spoilers. I can't wait till tomorrow night. I reckon I'll be fine on 7 hours sleep. And we watch another one. And then we go, do you know what? And now he's at the bottom of a well and there are 10 drug dealers over the top of him and they've all got bigger guns and one's got a machete. Well, he's definitely not getting out. Do you know what? I'll just watch the first 5 minutes of the next one. Oh, and do you know what they do at the first 5 minutes of the next one? Oh, they cut away to something else. They cut away to Skyler White's new job. Like bastards. And now I'm like, but he's in a hole. When are we going to get back to the hole, right? That's what they're doing all the time. They're teasing you with because of that. If you want your learners to binge learn, that's all you have to do. Because of that, what? Make them guess because of that. Now, you can even do it in an incredibly boring PowerPoint presentation, even if you do nothing else but this. So most people I notice what they're doing with their slides is they go, slide, 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 chat, 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 chat. And then they go, I've run out of things. Click. Oh yeah, some more things. So even if you just did this one thing, slide, 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 terribly written slide, lots of points on it. And the last point was, but because of that, you don't have to literally say the words because of that, but because of this boring number, or because of this boring idea, what? This slide. Even if you had anticipation as your 27th point on this slide, even if that, even you just had that, that the only slide that could come next was the next one. So instead of, you know when people use slides as memory prompts, because they don't really know the presentation, so that they'll do is they'll go, oh yeah, that. If you had the oh yeah, that at the end of this slide, even that would make the audience go, oh. Because our brains will be ignited by being tricked into thinking they're seeing a story, if because of that, or if you sort of say something that implies the audience has to guess what's coming next. So it could be, so we were really surprised to see this spike here, and we thought, what could that have come from? And we worked it out, it's this, click. The audience will then want to look at that slide. So even if you just did that, that would make things very different. Now I know a lot of you will not be teaching using slides, or getting people to learn through using slides, but a lot of people do. I see it all the time, this kind, and it sort of frustrates me that that's become our main form of communication in the corporate world is slides. Name the slide that's inspired you in life the most. No, the big hitter, the one that changed it, mixed it up. No, the slide that sort of mentored you through that difficult time. I mean, that could have been a slide deck, that mentored you through something. Like maybe even a favorite slide, even a memorable slide. Anyone got a memorable slide where you just go, that old slide? A slide has never changed anything. That's what you have to remember. A slide has never changed the world. The I Have a Dream slide deck makes no difference to the civil rights of disenfranchised people in America. Which is a shame, because it's coming round again and it's all we've got. True though. Human beings inspire each other. Stories inspire people. And the reason stories inspire people is that when you give people information, they can do one of two things with it. They can either only half the people here sort of took in what school I was from, and why should they? Why do they care? There's no reason for them to care. And that's honestly how we give information all the time. Some people have got good retention, some people haven't. Some people were focused at that second. Some people were thinking, did I leave the iron on in the hotel? That's always the case. Whenever the people that you're training learn anything, that's always the case. Half of them are not listening. Too many speakers, I noticed this in the corporate world, speakers assume that the audience are listening. That's the most common assumption I see in the corporate world, that the audience is listening. They're not. They're really not. Half of them aren't listening. At any given moment in time, half of them aren't listening. They're going, should have sent that email. But when you have a training session, e-learning, people aren't, they're just not quite engaged. They're not quite with you. The reason that a story works is that a story engages them, because they're wondering in a binge-watching way what's going to come next, but also they get to draw their own conclusions. So different people in this room will take different things away from a story in which I was basically made to feel less than because I wasn't blonde when I was 7 years old. So it depends. If you're someone who's blonde, you will take a different thing away from that story than if you're brunette. If you're someone who has a young child, you'll take a different thing away from that story than if you're someone who's just been asked to judge a beauty pageant, right? Everyone does their own work when they hear a story. If you hear the story of John and Margaret meeting up the top of the Eiffel Tower and now they're married, if you're in a cynical frame of mind, you take a different thing away from that story than if you're hopeful. If you're married, you take something different than if you're single. And if you're unhappily married, you take something different away than if you're happily married. So if you hear about John and Margaret and she runs after him and, you know, they end up happily married for 10 years and you're unhappily married, what do you start thinking about? Who was your one that got away? Who was the one you never went after? And you might think, I should never have broken up with him. I'm going to find him on Facebook. He's the one, right? If you're happily married, you think, oh, you're my Margaret. Love you. You're my John, right? Everyone takes a different thing away from a story. People do their own learning from a story. Everybody's brains are active and engaged. You can't hear a story. Is this a photo? Something's happening. I don't think you're allowed to video it, just to be clear, in case that's what's happening. Okay. I think there are some people here who are videoing it, though. Are they allowed the video afterwards? You're allowed the video afterwards. You don't want it on your crappy iPhone. Not to say that your iPhone is crappy, but relative to his enormous lens, it is. Where were we? Where are we in time, Gina? 25 minutes. How many minutes have I got left, I mean?
15 minutes,
great. Okay. So here's the thing. Say, somebody here shout out the name of their company. You, sir? I didn't think that was going to be such a difficult question. This feels like a bit of free marketing for you. What's your name? Oh, hold on. Give him a second.
Roberts.
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 Roberts. Oh, your name's Robert. Sorry. What's your company name?
Spaglioni.
Oh, smart learning, sorry. I think you should change it to Spaglioni. It's got a ring. It's very sticky. They enjoyed that one more, I'll be honest. Smart learning, they were like, yeah. That's what my company's kind of called. Whose company is sort of called smart learning, but not quite? Put your hand up if it's sort of called smart learning. Yeah, quite a few people are sort of, it's nearly. Spaglioni, I'm telling you. Everyone's gonna be like, what's that? So smart learning, if you were to tell the elevator pitch of smart learning to somebody here, who is the hero of that story? Who's the hero of smart learning? Smart learning the movie? Robert, or smart learning. Robert, do you own smart learning?
No.
No, you don't, okay, so not Robert. Robert's just a worker bee. But you might choose to make Robert, mightn't you? Because Robert's the one I'm talking to in the elevator, right? So it might be great if Robert tells me what he does, or he might choose to make smart learning the hero of that story. So over here we had somebody talk about, what was your name that you were talking about trying to convince that you're worth having in the organization?
Ricky.
So Ricky was talking about So basically, L&D trying to convince everybody else, hey, you should have us here because we really are of value, okay? So when Ricky's pitching L&D to the big bosses, who's the hero of that story? L&D, right? Yeah, that's pretty normal. Here's the thing, though. If I'm General Electric, and I meet Robert here, and I have a coffee with him, and he tells me about smart learning, who do I want to be the hero of the story? General Electric, yeah. I want to be the hero of the story. I want to be the hero of the story. If Ricky's pitching L&D to me, and what's your company?
Ala Foods.
Okay, Spaglioni. sounds like it should be in your range. Ala Foods. If she's talking to the CEO, who does the CEO want to be the hero of that story? Maybe. CEOs usually sort of think they've got it going on. What does the CEO care about? Customers?
Money.
Money, yeah. So Ricky could make money the hero of that story. But it depends what turns the CEO on, right? If the CEO keeps going on about what a people person he is and our people are the corner of our business, or whatever he says that he believes, he doesn't, but if he says all people are what we're all about here at Ala Foods, then she probably needs to tell the story of people. If the company is cutting back because they're losing money, she might need to make money the hero of that story, right? Now, what I notice is that people tell the same story to different people the same way, all the time. So I notice that people have like a keynote or a pitch or a piece of learning, a piece of training, and that's always delivered the same way with the same slides or the same words. But the audience, so in other words, this is always the hero of the story. But the audience care more about themselves than they do about this. So if I were to tell you a story about, I was talking to somebody once who was trying to train people around rolling stock and said that the rolling stock safety checks were not frequent enough and this was causing a higher percentage of accidents than necessary. What I worked out when I excavated it was that what they meant was is that if you got on a train this afternoon, you left here and you got on a train to Manchester and you sat down in the train and you got your cup of tea and you got your crisps and you had your iPad and you plugged yourself in and the train pulls off and you're thinking, great, it's 2 hours to Manchester. Halfway between here and the Watford Gap, your train could come off at the rails, smashing your carriage into a bridge, and you could die. Do you know why? Because the people doing the safety checks are themselves not checked. They're given the exam once, and then... So no matter what state they're in psychologically, no matter if they've forgotten a bit of crucial data, doesn't matter. They're not checked frequently enough, and so that's why you're now dead at the Watford Gap in a bridge. Halfway through that very important episode of Breaking Bad, which you never saw the end of. So now, that's more compelling, isn't it? Because you're in the story. Do you see the difference between that and rolling stock and health and safety? Rolling stock, health and safety, it's very hard to care. You tried, but you didn't. You made an effort, you did. Some of you made an effort, some of you blanked out, some of you made an effort to care. But in the second story, it's very, very difficult not to care because now I'm dead at the Watford Gap, and it's just not how I saw myself going. If I'm going to be killed, I'd like it to be Mayfair hit by a Porsche or something. I don't know. Business class air travel, I'd be fine with that. I don't want to be killed at the Watford Gap. It's just sad. So this is the thing. All of us here are more interested in ourselves than anybody else. really, ourselves, our own interests, and our own families. Now, we want to be helpful to other people as well, and that's why something like comic relief won't tell the story of a whole war-torn region in Africa and the number of people affected. They'll bring out one child and say, this child, this is where they live, picture of their house. They were with their mum and dad. They were really happy. This is the school they went to, and they'll show a bit of footage of that. And then this happened. And because of that, now this child is picking rubbish food out of a rubbish pile. So they tell the story of one child because it's more compelling. So in that, this person's the hero. And that's better than 100 people being the hero. But you being the hero is better than anything. So the question I need to ask you now is how, given that stories make learning sticky, active, engaging, and given that your learner is the best person to be the hero of the story, or at least one iconic individual needs to be the hero of the story that we can relate to and put ourselves in their shoes, what is the thing, the one defining feature that all heroes have? Any guesses as to the one defining thing that all heroes have?
Success.
Well, Richard III, don't want to give it away. Macbeth.
Anti-hero.
Yeah, an anti-hero, yeah, sure. Yeah, but they're a hero. A challenge, yeah? But then you might see a mumblecore movie where the hero really isn't challenged in any way, you know, a sort of indie film. They're not challenged in any way. They're challenged in that movie less than you've been challenged, or a sitcom. There's like mini challenges, but it's not really the defining feature. It's not the biggest thing about them. Superpowers. I know what sort of movies that you watch, Robert. Not all heroes have superpowers.
Saving the princess.
Saving the princess. Hashtag feminism. Sorry. These are all, by the way, you're all right. Some heroes have all these things. So you're all shouting good, true things about heroes, but none of them are what all heroes have. Yes? Sorry?
There's a
nemesis. Yeah, but sometimes there isn't. Sometimes, like in a sitcom, there's not always a villain. In a sketch, there's not. There'll be plenty of Anne of Green Gables. There's not really a villain. There's not a nemesis. There might be people they rub up against, and there will be people they rub up against or make their lives difficult. But it's not always a villain.
They're like yourself.
They're like yourself, but I would say Walter White's so not like me. In as much as I've limited experience with crystal meth. Sorry, what did you say? Central to the story, yes, that's true, but sometimes you'll see someone like Luke Skywalker is probably as central as Princess Leia, but it's definitely his story. Here's the one thing. You're all right about many heroes, but there is one thing that is true of all heroes. They're the person in the story that has changed the most. So Luke Skywalker is the hero of Star Wars because Princess Leia starts out as a princess in trouble and ends up as a princess who's battled something. Han Solo starts out as a mercenary and ends up as a slightly less cynical mercenary. But Luke Skywalker starts out as a farm boy. And he's with his aunt and his uncle and they're farming. And then Obi-Wan Kenobi comes along and says, you are a Jedi Knight. And he goes, I'm not a Jedi Knight. He goes, yeah, the Force is in you and you've got to come and save the galaxy from the dark side. I'm paraphrasing. And he goes, I don't want to. He goes, well, you have to, because you're the only one. Because Harry Potter starts off under the stairs, severely a challenging situation for him, but has no idea that he has these magical powers, right? And at the end, he's a great wizard. At the end, what's Luke Skywalker? He's a fantastic Jedi Knight, okay? The person in the story who has changed the most is the hero. So if you've got someone like Cinderella, everyone else in that story ends up with a slightly, they do change and they do learn, but they have slightly different attitudes at the end, but their circumstances are pretty much the same. But Cinderella sits by the fire at the beginning. She's made to do all the work. And at the end of the story, she's a princess. So the more that you can make your learner Start here and end there. The more you can come along and promise them that Jedi Knight change, the more exciting the learning is for them. Sometimes you want to say, oh, it's fine. It's not going to be very difficult. You sort of already know it. We'll just do a few things. And that's not as exciting for them as promising them change, showing them they're here and they could be there. But if they're Luke Skywalker, or in your case, if smart learning is, the person you're talking to in the elevator, Robert, is Luke Skywalker. So basically you're saying your company now is a farm boy, a brilliant farm boy, with the, look, I can see the potential to be a great Jedi Knight. Look at all the potential. Basically what you're saying is, you're a Jedi Knight, you just haven't unlocked that power yet. So that's a great pitch, okay? Or if Ricky, you're saying to the big bosses, we are a fantastic Jedi Knight, this company, but we haven't unleashed the power that we need to be. Right, okay, great, they're Luke Skywalker. Who do you need to be for them to be, to want you in the story? Because you could just tell a story about how great they are and they'll go, oh great, we're great, and they go off and leave you. You need to be central to the story too. And when you've got a piece of learning, you need that piece of learning for them to keep coming back to you. You can't just tell them they're great. Who do you need to be in that story? So give the example of Luke Skywalker. Yoda or Obi-Wan Kenobi, yes. You need to be, or the learning needs to be framed in a way that that piece of learning, or you in that elevator, or you talking to the people upstairs, you need to be Obi-Wan Kenobi. Because Obi-Wan Kenobi teaches Luke Skywalker what? To use his force, yes. To use a lightsaber. He trains him. What's the difference between that? Who are you? If they're Cinderella, who are you? Fairy godmother, yeah. What's the difference between Obi-Wan Kenobi and the fairy godmother? How does the fairy godmother change Cinderella? Magic wand, yeah. What does Cinderella do to get changed? Nothing. She just stands there. And the fairy godmother goes, all done. A carriage, horses, bye now. What's the difference between that and Obi-Wan? What does Obi-Wan do? He gives him the lightsaber. He doesn't take the lightsaber and go, let me kill some bad guys for you, that's how it's done. He teaches Luke Skywalker to use the lightsaber. Now, I think that's something to do with gendered storytelling. I notice a lot that male heroes get taught to be more powerful and female heroes get makeovers. Doesn't make me happy. What do you think your learners want to be? Do you think they want to be Luke Skywalker, or do you think they want to be Cinderella? And don't, I'm not fishing for an answer. Some of yours want to be Cinderella? Do you think they'd rather be Cinderella? Who can think of learners that would like to be Luke Skywalker, who want to learn to use the lightsaber? Who can think of learners that want to be Cinderella and just want it all done for them? Great, okay. So the fact that people in this audience can think of both mean you need to think about this. Now you may go, well, there's no way, I'm not a fairy godmother, I don't have magic, you're gonna have to learn. In which case, you have to seduce them into believing they can be Luke Skywalker, or think, at least thinking they want to be Luke Skywalker, right? If it's the people upstairs for Ricky, do they wanna be Luke Skywalker, or do they want to be Cinderella? Well, Ricky, only you can tell us. When it comes to L&D...
I think they would just like us to make them shine easily. So maybe a makeover.
Great, makeover, okay. And that's a really interesting point. So if you're taking someone and you're giving them career development learning, they may well want to take that lightsaber. They may well... Or if they want to work with smart learning, that may need to be a collaboration, and they may want to work with smart learning for 2 years so that they can then create their own brilliant in-house program, because now they understand what learning is and how it works, right? So they may want to be Luke Skywalker. The chaps upstairs and the women upstairs who are running around making the whole thing work, they may not want L&D to say, and we're going to teach you how to teach. But they might just go, that's your job, why am I paying you? Get your magic wand, go downstairs. I don't need to hear how it happens. Now, they may want to. You need to find out Who are you to that person? And to one person, you'll be Obi-Wan, and to one person, you'll be Yoda, who is teaching an Obi-Wan to teach a Luke Skywalker, and to another person, you may be a fairy godmother. But what you need to know more than anything is that a hero is a person who changes. If you cannot deliver change to them, then you don't have a story. And if you don't have a story, they're less likely to come to you. You probably have to impose your learning on them. As soon as you make them feel like a hero, everything's going to change. Now, I do have a day coming up for the Guilty Feminist. It's a learning day around impact, charisma, charismatic behavior. It's not this, but there will be elements of this in it, but mostly it's about how to take up space. It's on the 22nd of May. It's £195 for the day, but the reason I'm telling you is if you take hashtag LT17UK and you put it in, that is a discount code because you've been here, because we love Donald and the whole of learning technology, and we want to give back. It's not really a very convincing story, is it? People have just looked at me and gone, no, you don't. So if anyone's around on 22nd of May and would like to come, there is a sort of early bird discount that you can use if you book it fairly soon with that to talk more about story. But before I go, do you have any questions about story? Do you have any questions? John has.
I have been wanting to know for the past hour, did the school win the competition?
I don't think they won. I think they placed. But do you know what? It's interesting. It's not on the spine of the story. What they did, the winners were the people that got into the competition, right? If I had got into the dance troupe and I'd lost us the competition by falling over, then that would be on the spine of the story,
right?
Do you see what I mean? It's interesting, isn't it? But I will tell you one thing. I was telling that story within a show and in London. It was like a preview for an Edinburgh Festival show. And as I was telling the story, I looked into the audience and I was like, oh my God. And I stopped and I said to this person in the audience, I went, are you Jo Burnett? And she went, yep. And I went, you were in that dance troupe, weren't you? And she went, yep. And she was like, I'm so sorry. And I hadn't seen her for years. And I knew she was living in London, but she hadn't said she was coming to the show. I honestly hadn't seen her in years. And she had just sort of seen that I was doing a show and come along and thought, oh, well, I'll go and say hi afterwards. Anyway, afterwards, we all went to the pub. And I said, do you remember? She said, of course I remember the dance. And I said, do you remember Miss Power saying all the blonde girls stand up? She said, no, I don't. And her husband said, of course she doesn't. So because she was in the group, she was in the privileged group. So, you know, and that's an interesting thing. That there's another way of telling that story that ends with that. Yeah. That has its own conclusion about what we remember and what we don't remember based on whether or not we have privilege. And that's the definition of privilege is...
You don't notice it.
Is, yeah, you just get, you get shoved into the good group, and from there you think you've got your own problems. Yeah. Any other questions before I have to go? Yes.
So for the man wanting to dye his daughter's hair blonde, the competition being won or not won would be on the spine of the story.
Oh, good point, yes. Yeah, they didn't win. Don't do it. It's disastrous. And they are all currently now, unfortunately, addicted to crystal meth. It's very sad.
One final question, yes. Down here.
Supposition for Don. Don, I'm guessing you're not going to be distributing the slides after this, are you? for you, actually,
that slide will be fully available. You can download that.
Tell me a slide that really inspires you, sir.
I'm chucking this back at you. You challenged us to mention texts that have impressed us and changed our lives. How about you on the flip side, the story that impressed you and changed your life?
Oh, what was the story that changed my life? Oh, that's question. Really interesting. Oh, wow.
Your memory's worse than this guy here.
No, I'm just sort of trying to choose one. So do you mean a story I heard or a story that happened to me?
Preferably one with you in it.
Preferably one with me in it. Okay. All right. I was in a cult. I was a Jehovah's Witness, and I believe it's a cult because you can't have any friends outside, and the punishment for contravention of the rules is being shunned by everyone, so you're left alone. And I was a nanny, and you're not allowed to do anything. Like, they encourage you to stay single and not have children because Armageddon's coming, and so you need to keep knocking on doors telling people about Armageddon. So they encourage you not to go to uni. I wasn't allowed to go to uni. They encourage you basically to stop living your life and just knock on doors. And I was working as a nanny, and I went to pick up this little girl from ballet, and we were all of the parents and the nannies were standing outside this window looking in at the little girls dancing at the end of the class. And I saw this man next to me, who was obviously a dad, and he was looking in and he was looking at his daughter, and he had so much kind of pride on his face and happy. He was just so happy and overwhelmed, like watching her dance. And I looked at him and I thought, I want that. And I don't think I'm going to get another life. I don't think this paradise, eternal life is going to come. I think if I'm going to live my life, I have to start today. And that was the day I walked away from the cult.
Wow.
Yeah, that was probably the day it changed. But also John and Margaret up the Eiffel Tower. That one really changed me. Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Deborah Frances-White.
John, can I just say, please go to guiltyfeminist.com. where you can find out about the Include Yourself Day, or you can just listen to the podcast for free. That's the other thing you can do. Guiltyfeminist.com. Thank you so much for having me. You guys are great.